Well, Merry Christmas. Good to see all of you guys again. We had a great time at the Christmas Eve service. It was great to definitely come together for that. And I want to talk to you today as we're finishing out our sermon series, Bundle of Joy. I got to be honest with you. I kind of kept bugging God and saying, God, you know, I really need to know what I'm going to be preaching in December. And I was praying and God was pretty quiet. And I kept saying, hey, you know, God, I really need to know. And so then God finally gave it to me. And it made a lot of sense when he first gave it to me, Bundle of Joy. And then I was like, okay, but what's that look like? And it was a concept that, you know, I've really seen how God has used that concept to cause me to even be in prayer more than normal. And to really grasp that, okay, wait, Bundle of Joy, and really see what God wants to say within that. Not just kind of make a surface level. And so I think it's been one of those series that you could probably go back and look at some of the sermons and really kind of glean some more, because it's just a different angle of taking things. And so we've talked about how Jesus is the bundle of joy that's come into our lives, but not like a typical bundle of joy where we teach that bundle of joy how to walk and talk, but rather he's come and he teaches us how to walk, talk, and live and smile. And that's part of the joy, is that we have a Savior. Part of that is the whole restoration process. Him teaching us to walk, talk, and live, and the smile is a result of what he did to die for us, of his working with us, that discipleship, that restoring process, that remaking process. First of all, who am I that God would want to spend time with a donkey like me to teach me how to walk and talk right, and I don't always cooperate? But the joy is that his commitment is there, despite my failure. And so we've talked about that he teaches how to walk right, how to talk differently. We use the language of the kingdom, so to speak. And then also how to live differently to restore our lives back. And what I want to do today is, as we're finishing up 2015, this is the last sermon of 2015. This is the last time we're going to meet together, 2015. I can't believe it. As we're finishing one year and entering into another, I think it's really makes sense in the Lord to kind of challenge us about what makes us smile. And that he wants to be that source. Did you know that? He wants to be the source of our smile. You might not get that promotion. You might not get that raise. The things might not go the way that you want. You might have unresolved issues from this year that are coming in the next year. And you got to work through them and you got to go through them. And part of the smiling is that God is working with you and in you in these things. And so I want to touch on that today. And I'm going to be honest, I'm going to kind of... As I go through this, it's going to kind of be deep, kind of in another way. So I want to challenge you, just kind of stick with me in this, because I'm really hoping that this would carry over into your, some of you guys got some downtime work-wise or whatever. I would encourage you to really take time. Now, when I say meditate, I'm not talking like Middle Eastern, you know, meditating. Okay, the word meditate means to think on that thing. I want to, in the word of God, actually says meditate on the word of God. I want to encourage you to really focus. Take time over these next few weeks and focus on this. And here's what I'm going to tell you in advance. All these that I'm going to talk about today, I want to challenge you to maybe say, which one of these, maybe even put them in order. Which one do I need to work on or apply in my life first? And then which one second once I get that down? And kind of begin to get on these things. You're going to see what I'm going to talk about when I get there. You know, there are those who smile easily and those who don't. Those who are always smiling and those who are not. And what happens is we generally like to judge those that it's an issue of what's going on in someone. But we don't know that for certain. That something, you know, that they're an angry person or not a happy person. Because there's personality types. Some personality types just don't show things on the outside. I've learned that in my studies and schooling that I've gone to and learning to work with people. That's how some people are wired. And so we're real easy to quick to think like, oh, they're angry or they're mean. Now, it is a good idea to be conscious of yourself socially and to be aware if you appear to be inviting or not, you know, and that's a good thing. That's what helps you, because sometimes people will misread you, and that's sad, you know. But be honest, though, with how God's wired you. But that's not what I'm talking about here today. One of the things that Jesus has brought into our lives is the ability to find satisfaction and contentment in life. He's given us that ability. And we can take this and look at it also outside of this life. because it's not just a here and now. It has to, if you think, so to speak, multidimensional, if you will. Today, though, I don't want to confuse smiling with only physically. I'm not talking about a physical smile, trying to paint on a smile and be, oh, everything's great. That's not what I'm talking about. I kind of want to go down the road of smiling on the inside, where your heart is warmed, where there's a contentment. We don't touch on contentment enough. We don't touch on this enough on the inner stuff. And so oftentimes you can be in a stressful situation or dealing with a loss, or your body is failing on you. And when you go through the stressful times, your face at times and your body will show that. But on the inside, you can still have, so to speak, a smile, a happiness, a joy, and where it's not fake. And you can actually be honest and say, my body is killing me. And you're not smiling outwardly, but you can say, that's okay. It's a smile that though you may not like this, you have hope. You will get through it. You have other things to focus on. You trust Jesus despite what's going on. Say despite. You trust Jesus despite what's going on. And this is determined by some things. So write this down. Number one, here's what I'm saying is, what's the source of your smile? What's the source of your smile? What makes you smile? What makes you happy? Who or what gives you joy in life? Have you ever taken the time to evaluate what you are basing that on? If I get more of this, if I get more of that, if there's less of this, if there's less of that, that's what it's about. Identify those things. I'll have to admit, I haven't done that as much as I probably should in my life. But as I look back at my life, I see how that has changed over the years. It has increasingly become more and more about the things of God. More and more it's become about the things of God that make me smile. And if I'm not careful, other things can creep in and distract me. And that's what I want to talk about, that distraction that takes place. I remember I couldn't have a good Sunday, even as a pastor, unless I was able to watch my team. It was hard. It was a sacrifice to not be able to watch my team on Sundays. I was always hoping they would play after church. And then when there was night service, how many of you guys remember when night services were around? Remember when there were Sunday night services, right? So you wanted your team to be playing in between Sunday morning service and Sunday night service, if you could catch the game, right? And remember, I wanted to watch my team, but then I noticed how my day was affected if my team won or lost, and how close they were getting to the playoffs. Now listen, I'm all for sports, I'm all for entertainment. However, I had to get a grip on what was causing or affecting me to smile or scowl. Now, I know it's so minimal when I'm talking about football, but that was so big. It was really big in my life at one point. And, you know, when you're immature or you're younger in the Lord, you grow in these things. And things that seem big, then you look back and you're like, really? Wow. But that's the beauty of God. God wants to grow us in these things. And there are things that God wants to challenge you in right now today that seem big, that later will seem small. Or things that seem small and you're like, really, God? Come on, that's... And then later on, you'll see how big it was. Are you guys getting this? This is what I want you to get, because it affects you. Because otherwise, we'll never have enough. There'll never be enough. And we can't ever enjoy God the way He wants us to enjoy Him. And all these things get in the way, and we're controlled by the enemy and the ups and downs of life. And so I remember I had to just step away from that. And I realized what I was looking to was letting me down. Look at Philippians chapter 4, verses 4 through 7. It says this. Always be full of what? Joy. But joy of what? In the Lord. We'll get to that in a minute. I say it again. Rejoice. Why do you think he said it twice? Because he knows it's going to be challenged. There's going to be problems. Now let everyone, he says this, let everyone see that you are considerate in all you do. That's why when my kids get grumpy, or even when I get grumpy, I go, you know what, that was an excuse. I'm having a bad day. What does that mean? I'm having a bad day. Is it okay to be grumpy, to be mean with somebody? Oh, somebody steps on my foot. No, that's not the way it should be, right? So, you guys don't have bulletins, huh? No? Hey, can someone help Heath hand out some bulletins here? Mike's got some too. That way you guys could track along. Anybody didn't get one that wants one? All right. Thanks for getting that taken care of, Heath. Appreciate that. Thanks for all you guys' help, too, Warren and Steve. All right, so the first thing you're going to write down in your notes is what's the source of your smile? Okay? And then the scripture that we're looking at, Philippians 4, 4 through 7, is this. Always be full of joy in the Lord. I say it again and rejoice. Let everyone see that you're considerate in all that you do. Remember, the Lord is coming soon. Don't worry about anything. Instead, pray about everything. Tell God what you need and thank Him for all He has done. Then you will experience God's peace, which exceeds anything we can understand. His peace will guard your hearts and minds as you live in Christ Jesus. Gosh, I could just go off forever on this. How attached this is. I mean, I'm telling you, one of the best things you can do is spend from now till next Sunday just dissecting that right there. And then what I'm going to dissect after that. But understand, you can't have joy if you're always caught up in the worries that the enemy wants you to worry. There are things that are legitimate that concern us, but don't sit there and worry about it. Bring it to God. Because when you bring it to God, then you put it in the hands of one that can do with it, which you never could. And then you leave it to His judgment, and you leave it to Him, that despite whether it turns out the way that you want, you know that God's going to use it. You know that God has a plan, and that's where your peace comes. But when I'm holding on to things myself, right? Think of it like this. Let's say, God forbid, you cut your arm off, okay? You're chopping down a tree, and you're, oh, that's not a branch. Oh, my gosh. What am I going to do? Now, yes, you should worry if you're just sitting there holding your arm. But is your arm in the right hands if you're holding on to your own arm? No. But you can have peace if you get to the doctor, right? Well, who's the doctor of our lives? Jesus. So think of it like that. Sometimes your arm's chopped off, and we're sitting there, and you tell everybody, look at my arm, and they start worrying with you. Oh my gosh, your arm, look at your arm. And I'm like, my arm, and everyone's freaking out. And then finally someone goes, why don't we pray? And you're like, okay. And then you pray, and then you go, all right. Unless you don't trust God, then they'll keep saying, my arm, right? I want you to circle in the Lord. Because it's important that we walk and talk about this the right way. See, if we accept the Lord for who He really is, then that is truth. And it's eternal. And it's not circumstantial. In the Lord means this. Listen to me. First of all, it does not mean that you are happy for all things that happen to you, even the bad. But it does mean, and it also doesn't mean that you fake it. It doesn't mean that you ignore how you're really doing too. It says bring it to God. Bring it. You cannot have peace unless you bring it to Him. But rather it means that despite what the world does, it can't take the joy that you find in Jesus. It means because the hope and the future in Him are eternal and unchanging. Despite that this world will change and it's not eternal. It's because everything outside of God is circumstantial. Everything. And everything outside God is temporary. And actually, many times, it's artificial. If you look at a few verses later, which we'll be totally dissecting verse 8 in a minute, but in detail, in an expository manner, so we go from 4 to 7, and then we'll look at 8 in a minute, but I want to jump past 8 to verse 11, because verse 11 is very telling of the effect of making Jesus the source of His smile. This is the Apostle Paul. So let's put this together. Verse says, always be full of joy in the Lord. I say it again, always, rejoice. Then Paul breaks it down in verse 8, which we're going to do in a minute. And then to be full of the Lord's joy. And then verse 11, he gives the result Read this out loud with me. Ready? I have learned to be satisfied with the things I have and with everything that happens. How many people in the world can say that? What people group in the world can say that? Very few, only believers. This is what God wants for us. He wants us to be able to say this. How? How can Paul say that? How can he say that after being whipped multiple times, rocks thrown at him so that he'd be killed multiple times for making Jesus his source? How? It's because of who the Lord is and focusing on him. So then what are we to do? Well, number two, decide in advance what your source will be. What's the source of your smile? Well, you got to decide. Whose decision is it? It's yours. People all around you are going to... I want you to do me a favor. I want you to do a study of commercials. And you watch what every commercial tries to tell you. You'll be happy if. You'll smile if. You'll have joy if. All these different things. You mean if I buy your laundry soap, I'll finally be happy? That's amazing, because I haven't had joy. But now if I, in fact, it's called cheer. Wow. Wow. Right? I mean, look at these things. It's ridiculous. What I mean here is this. What is going to be your source to bring you happiness, joy, and have a glad heart? What are you going to draw from? What are you going to rely upon? Joshua 24, verse 15, look at what he says. You're very familiar scripture. Read this out loud with me. But if serving the Lord seems undesirable to you, then choose for yourselves this day whom you will serve, whether the gods your forefathers served beyond the river or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you are living. But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. Now understand this. Joshua, when he said this, was standing before the people who were called the people of God. And he's having to tell them to decide. He had to challenge them to live like it. To live by it. To live for it. But why? Because it had to be a what? A decision. It doesn't matter whether you sit here or not. What matters is the decision that you daily make that is your source. And that is going to be challenged this year. I promise you, it was challenged last year. It's going to be challenged this year. You have to decide in advance. When something that you don't want happens, what do you have to draw from? Or are you hopelessly devastated? Devastation will come at some point in life. But are you hopelessly devastated or are you hopefully devastated? This might take my life physically, but I will live forever. I don't want to die. I want to live. I want to watch my kids grow and all that stuff. But you know what? I'll grieve the loss, but in my heart, I know it's not the end. Romans 12:2 says this, don't change yourselves to be like the people. This scripture is prefacing what we're going to dissect here. So pay attention to this. Don't change yourselves to be like the people of this world, but be changed within by a new way of thinking. Then you'll be able to decide what God wants for you. See, we try and decide what God wants for us in all these other ways. But we got to do it this way first. Then you will know what God wants for you. You will know what is good and pleasing to him, and what is perfect. Now, it's so sad that a lot of people in the world, and how they just keep running in circles trying to find satisfaction. Job to job, relationship to relationship. Even people go from church to church. Well, I'm just not getting fed there. Are you eating what's before you? No. Even people go from church to church because it's all about them. But when you yield, listen to me, when you yield and surrender to Jesus, instead of saying, Lord, give me, you say, Lord, how do you want me to use this? What do you want to do with this? You know, that's a foreign way of thinking compared to the world around us, isn't it? And so, but it requires the decision of deciding who or what is your source. Psalm 37, verse 4, take delight in the Lord, and he will give your heart's desire. take delight in the Lord. It doesn't mean you get what you want. When you hear a preacher tell you that you're going to get what you want, they obviously don't know the Word of God. They're not preaching. They didn't study. It's almost comical. It doesn't mean that you get what you want. It means that in God is what you desire. Did you get that? Take delight in the Lord. Lord, my delight's in you. Whatever you want, whatever you have, whatever you want to do, whatever you don't want to do, my delight's in you because you're God. Instead of saying, God, I want this, so I'm going to give it up to you because I know you'll give that to me. And God's like, what about what I want? What about my plans? It doesn't mean God is a genie or that God is going to make you rich or material prosperity. It means spiritually. Say spiritually. God is our source. He'll take care of us. He will take care of us. But this is meaning spiritually. See, you decide what is your source, but you have to realize what you are really looking for is in one place. If it is only found in the Lord. So when you choose Him to be your source, you're choosing to take delight. Or as Paul said, to be content with no matter what happens, because you know He is with you and for you, and has plans that are much bigger and much better than yours. God has plans that are so much better than us. The Bible says we can't even imagine. The Bible actually says we can't even imagine the things that God can do for us. Sometimes when I'm praying, I just go, God, I just have your way. I can't even imagine right now. Whatever you want. So here's what I want you to do. So how do we do this? We're going to look at whatever. Say whatever. All right? So I know, how many of you guys ever had a teenager? Right? Whatever. Get over here. Why'd you do that? Whatever. Right? Steve, is that surrender? Oh, God, I've had a couple of them. God, right? Whatever, right? Well, we get to do whatever here today. See, you need to feed your spirit, your mind, your heart, the things of God that give you more to smile about and to focus on those things, because that is how you draw from the source. Now listen, what you focus on is where you'll end up, and where you end up is where you will probably live. And a lot of us are living spiritually in the wrong place. We're not enjoying the things of God, the peace of God that Paul talked about. Philippians 4:8, we're going to dissect this, okay? And now, dear brothers and sisters, one final thing. Fix your thoughts on what is true and honorable and right and pure and lovely and admirable. Think about these things that are excellent and worthy of praise. Remember Romans 2 said, when we start thinking God's way, that's where we get tested to prove what His will is. That's where we can have the peace in those things and know what He wants. So I want to break this down. Let's really look at how the Lord is our source. And it's not just a salvation thing. It's a living thing. It begins with our thinking. Philippians 4:8 says this, whatever, and then it says, think about such things, right? At the end of this verse, in the NIV, it reiterates to think on these things, okay? Think about such things, as you see right there. So number one, whatever is true. Say true. Whatever is true. That's how we do this. That's how we see, make Him our source. Think about whatever is true. Think about it. All the things you're thinking about, all the things that enter in your mind. First of all, you receive it here generally, and you're like, okay, what do I do with it? And then it trickles down, and then you start acting and doing all those ways. It's crazy. You got to begin to think about the things of God. There are a lot of lies out there trying to get us to focus on it. Get rich schemes, prosperity preaching, teachers, churches, TV channels, commercials, magazines, people you work with, people in your life, people in your family, all these different things. Do this. Do what feels good. Sleep around if it feels good. Do whatever. Philippians 4:8 says, finally, brothers, whatever is true. Think about whatever is true. It is important that you find the truth of something. Listen to me. Otherwise, you're going to end up in heartache and heartbreak. This world will lie to you just to get from you what it wants because it's selfish. And that in turn makes you selfish because you get hurt. And you go, the only way I have joy is to hurt others and rob from them what I want. This world doesn't value Jesus. It values evil. And so Jesus said, Satan is the father of all lies. That's his native language. So if you look at a lot of what this world is really trying to tell us, it's all lies. You ever watch those infomercials? Right? You ever see those ones? Those are the classic commercials. Those are the best ones, right? You know, it's lies. John 8, 31 through 32 says this. Read this out loud with me. Jesus said to the people who believed in him, stop. If you believe in Jesus, raise your hand. So this is what he's saying to us here today. Now keep reading with me. You are truly my disciples if you remain faithful to my teachings, and you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Jesus is prefacing verse 32, if you, A, believe in him, and then B, you will be faithful to what he says. If you believe in him, you'll be faithful to what he says, because you believe in him. Now catch this. He says after that is when you know the truth. If you believe in me, then you'll be faithful to what I have. And when you do that, that truth will set you free. He says after that is when you know the truth, and the truth sets you free. And once we have the truth, we're not supposed to come back. We're not supposed to go back the other way. Watch this.
Do you want to know what it is? The Matrix is everywhere. It is all around us. Even now, in this very room. You can see it when you look out your window or when you turn on your television. You can feel it when you go to work, when you go to church, when you pay your taxes. It is the world that has been pulled over your eyes to blind you from the truth.
What truth?
That you are a slave, Neo. Like everyone else, you were born into bondage. Born into a prison that you cannot smell or taste or touch. A prison for your mind. Unfortunately, no one can be told what the Matrix is. You have to see it for yourself. This is your last chance. After this, there is no turning back. You take the blue pill. The story ends. You wake up in your bed and believe whatever you want to believe. You take the red pill. You stay in Wonderland. And I show you how deep the rabbit hole goes. Remember, all I'm offering is the truth, nothing more. Follow me.
Many of us live our Christianity, take that blue pill over and over again. We want the truth, but we're just caught up in this. You can't know the freedom of Christ if you reject him. What about the influences in your life? Is money really going to make you more happy? Is fame? Is more sex? Think about the roads that we get distracted going down because we think it will make us smile more, only to find out that it's not true. Decide in advance to smile at what is true. What about the shows you watch, the sites you visit, the technology that we engage, Facebook, etc., all these things, the music we listen to, is it really making you smile more? John 14, 6 says this. Jesus told him, I'm the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me. I encourage you to compare. I want you to listen to what I tell you right now. Compare. Compare what you consider to make you smile or feed your joy. Compare that to Jesus. How does it compare to Jesus? Really, when the world wants you to bite onto something, wants you to get something, wants you to succumb to some kind of temptation, compare it to Jesus. Let's see. If I cheat on my spouse, how does that compare to Jesus? Boy, it loses. If I just pour myself into a career and have nothing to do with what God wants me to do, my purpose in my life. How's that compare? Just start comparing things. It's real simple. Now, I don't want to confuse pre-conversion and being raised in church. What I want to say here is that challenge here is what happens in us. And sometimes it is a battle within us. The things we used to do, like before we came to Jesus. Now, what I mean is I don't want to confuse pre-conversion and being raised in church. Because for some of you, that you are raised in church, and for the most part, there is no before Jesus. You're raised in church. So there's not really, when people talk about that before you got saved, that's a confusing thing. But I want to say that part of your life, and so when you look at this, when a preacher says, like how you were before Jesus, you assume it doesn't relate to you because you've always known or followed Jesus. But realize it does include you, because the bigger thing I'm talking about is not so much prior to conversion. I'm talking about how we think and act in our sin nature versus obeying and walking in the ways of the Lord. Doing the sin nature or Jesus. If you consider Christ to be your Savior, then regardless if you were raised in church or saved last Sunday, you still have a battle going on within you to either do what is sin or Jesus would want. But when you compare what your sin nature may want to do with what Jesus has, it doesn't compare. You guys following me? I'm talking about after we're saved, what are we going to do? Compare it to Jesus. Right now. The things that, what is your hope list for 2016? I'm not saying it's bad to have ambitions. But I'm saying, what's going to happen if you don't get that? Is your year going to be thrown off? Your relationship is going to be thrown off? Just leave me alone. Why? I didn't get the promotion. Philippians 3, 7 through 9. I once thought these things were valuable, but I consider them worthless because of what Christ has done. Yes, everything else is worthless when compared to the infinite value of knowing Christ, Jesus as my Lord. For his sake, I have discarded everything else, counting it all as garbage so that I could gain Christ and become one with him. Guys, it's not poor me, what I'm going to say right now. But it's pretty tough. I'm thankful that we have FaceTime, but it's pretty tough to look into your parents' eyes, your family's eyes, your sister's eyes, your aging grandparents' eyes, and not be able to touch them on Christmas. It's my first time ever. And for an Italian boy, that's big. But I'm here because that's what Jesus wants. And even if it wasn't what Jesus wants, I'm here and I'm going to make the best of it. Because compared to anything else, it's rubbish. My family's saved. I'm going to see them in heaven. Does it mean I miss them now? Yes. But when I compare, I go, I'll have eternity. I can sacrifice the things in this life because God's given me eternity. It's a great trade-off. When I compare, it's all rubbish. The NIV says rubbish. It's all garbage compared. Yes, I missed them. Yes, I would love to see them. Yes, they would love to see me. And I can't blame them because I'm the most favorite grandson and the favorite child. Sorry, Tracy, but but it's all garbage compared to Jesus. He's amazing. Now, yes, many of the things that are wrong can be fun. But it doesn't last. And so we sacrifice it at first. And sooner or later, when our nature begins to change, you don't see it as so much fun anymore because the things that we thought were fun aren't fun. But even this is that this sacrifice is okay in my heart. Because whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. B, think about whatever is noble. Now, noble or honorable are not valued words in our society today, agreed? We don't talk about them much. But in God's kingdom, they are very valuable. Philippians 4, 8, whatever is noble. Now, the Greek word there is semnos. Say semnos. You guys are speaking Greek today. This means grave or reverent. Now, I want to hang out here for a minute because what it's saying is that to have a sense of seriousness about reality, to have a sense of seriousness about your reality, this world's reality, about the mission of the reality that God has for you. This is the same word used when talking about overseers in the church, to be reverent. Grave means to have the same respect or reverence as if you were at a grave. That means take this pretty serious. What is this rubbish? What are you going to lay down? What are you living for? Now, that might not seem to be making too good of a point in the sermon talking about joy, okay? But don't confuse joy with happiness or laughter, because there are some things that people laugh at and find joy in, but they are disrespectful things and ungodly things. Agreed? Now, this is saying live nobly, reverently, gravely, in that there is a line of right and wrong. There is a line. Have fun, laugh, enjoy life, but not at the cost of forgetting the mission that God has for you. Not at the cost of forgetting that there is a heaven and that there is a hell, not just in your life, but for every living person. Don't seek joy or laughter or smiling out that you sin in it, or try to medicate or gloss over something and not take it serious. Don't be surface level. It means to be real. Don't just be religious, but it means to be open and real with God. The King James translates it as honest. We think that we are being more godly when we pretend. Guys, how many guys want to have the joy of the Lord this next year? Want to be able to have the most successful spiritual year ever? How many guys want that this next year? Listen to me. We think about being more godly. We think we're being more godly when we pretend that everything is okay. You know what that's called? It's called being religious. Fake. Religion is fake. We're not supposed to be religious. And religion helps no one. Religion helps no one. It's fake godliness. It is a form of idolatry. You rob people of opportunities to be used of God when you say that things are going good when they're not. And you're lying. You are hurting yourself. You're living a lie. You're robbing yourself and telling God what he has provided for you in those gifts and, you know, whatever people are giving you, whatever's happening in your life, that it's not enough. God's giving you the brothers and sisters here with gifts of prayer, with gifts of comfort and encouragement and counsel. And you're trying to say like it's not going to help you when you pretend like you're okay. Be open. This is a hospital. It's a hospital for sinners. It's not a country club for Christians. Open up and be honest. If someone asks you how you are doing and you have an ache or a pain or an issue, tell them. I bet you start seeing how God places you around someone with the gift of intercession or encouragement of wisdom. And I'm not talking about every little ache and pain. Well, I got a paper cut, right? Okay? I'm talking about being real, the things that are affecting your spirit. Also, you rob yourself of the opportunity to be used of God. How can God use you to help others if you are not honest about people needing help? How can you ever see the gift of healing take place if you never say, I need healing? Would you pray for me? You know what the Bible word for help is? This is good. You might want to write this down somewhere. I'm going to tell you what the Bible word for help is. Ministry. The Bible says the Holy Spirit gives everybody a gift of the Spirit so they can do what? Ministry. Ministry is help. Ephesians 4:16. He makes the whole body fit together perfectly. And as each part does its own special work, it helps the other parts grow so that the whole body is healthy and growing and full of love. You guys, listen to me. When we're not honest, when we're not noble, semnos, then how in the world can the church be healthy, growing, and full of love? The Bible says when one part hurts, the other part hurts. You know what spiritual gifts, spiritual ministry, spiritual helps are proof of? They're proof that God is saying, you're going to have problems. There's a gift of healing because you're going to have problems. There's a gift of intercession because you're going to need to be prayed for. There's a gift of discernment because the devil's going to try and confuse you. There's the gift where people can comfort one another because you're going to get uncomfortable and you're going to get hurt and you're going to have problems. But in this world, you can take heart because I've overcome this world and I'm here by my Holy Spirit living in you that has given you gifts to be there with one another. That's why there's a bit of heaven on earth because His Holy Spirit is in us. My solution, God is saying, is for you to be an extension of me to one another. as if I was there. So one will be an extension of my healing, one of my counsel, one of my wisdom, my encouragement, greater level of faith, and of my mercy. Stop calling God a liar by being fake and start being semnos, honest. Because when you do that, that is truly noble. It takes a brave person to be honest. This will provide times for us to smile. Because you don't carry issues alone. And you let Jesus use you to help others too. Feed your spirit the things of God that give you more to smile about. Going after spiritually right things enables you to walk more on authentic Christianity. Nobody likes having to be fake. You're not pretending that it's all okay. You're being brave and you're taking on the real issues and you face them and you're listening to others to fight to you and you say, even if it might not turn out the way that I want, I still have joy and trust in my God. But I'm not going to quit fighting and I'm going to keep going on. You guys, I'm amazed. You guys might not even see it the way I see it, but I'm amazed at what I just see the way God puts things together. I never would have known that I was going to go into this sermon series and then this sermon that I'm going into and how it's totally, completely prefacing what God is going to start next week with this next sermon series, Beneath the Surface of Emotions. Today, for us to be talking about what we're thinking about and focusing on and then prefacing that with Beneath the Surface of Emotions, I'm going to tell you guys, beginning next week, I'm telling you right now, I'm going to have you do something in the middle of the service that is going to be so revealing. This next week, I'm talking about identify. You will literally, literally be able to identify next week where you are at emotionally. And then the next 7 weeks after that, I'm going to help build you and structure you and grow. You might think, oh, I'm good. I got it down. Don't go there. Trust me. We're going to grow in this. I'm telling you, you got to be here. You got to make sure you tell the others that are not here, that are off in this, wherever they're doing. Tell them you got to make sure you get back on track next week. Today is a total prequel. It's amazing how God does this. See, whatever is right. Think about whatever is right. We live in a world where they can't agree on absolute right or wrong, so we just left to ourselves. And the sad thing is it's hard to find what to think of regarding right and wrong outside of God. Philippians 4:8, whatever is right. Now, the word for right here comes from where we get righteous. It was originally communicated right-wise. Did you know that? That's how the word righteous came about, through the word right-wise, meaning to be in the right way. Right-wise. Be right-wise. However, this word can also mean justice. We live our lives in a way that treats people right. This is what they're saying. To live your lives in a way that treats people right, that is honest, that is caring, that is waiting, or that is wanting to be just, to have justice for others. I'm a big justice person. I hate injustice. Literally hate it. Hate it. When we decide to be right before God and man, we naturally have something to smile about because we have peace. Agreed? Right? And so also, we decide to value the things that are right. We have peace with God and ourselves. It feels nice to look back when we can see what we did was right. It feels nice. It makes you smile. Man, look at, there's an improvement. Yeah, way back there. But fairly recently, wow, praise God. Because you're living right. You're living justly. Tell yourself, I want to look back on this moment right now and see I did the right thing. So start from today. Though a righteous man falls 7 times, he gets back up. So say, I fell 7 times, but that's going to be the last time. I'm going to get up. I'm going to go after God again. But you have to decide, otherwise you'll look back and you'll keep having regrets. Proverbs 5, which is talking about avoiding adultery, because the regret that you will have and how it'll compound itself is, you're going to get caught. But think about also what captures we avoid as a whole when we learn to live right. So think about this, applying it to all sin or doing the right thing or not. Proverbs 12, or 5, 12 to 14. You will say, how I hated discipline. If only I had not ignored all the warnings. Oh, why didn't I listen to my teachers? Why didn't I pay attention to my instructors? I've come to the brink of utter ruin, and now I must face public disgrace. You guys, you see, I think as we think in advance to live right, that's why it says think on these. Think how, what decisions are you going to make? What positions are you going to put yourself into? Think in advance, right, just, correct, because then you'll have more smiles in your future. Because when you look back, you don't have any regret. Are we going to be perfect? Of course not. 2 Corinthians 5:21. Read this out loud with me. For God made Christ, who never sinned, to be the offering for our sin so that we could be made right with God through Christ. What this means is though we won't 100% choose to live right, and we will have regrets as we look back, we are to live in a way to avoid the regrets as much as possible, to have that smile, to have that inner peace, even though we fail, because Christ covered it. But this is also talking about to evaluate right from wrong, to decide in advance, to saying like you don't want to allow yourself to get into a situation that's harder to say no to. If you struggle with drunkenness, why would you go to a bar? Why would you go to a bar anyways? I don't know, unless you're really, truly going there to save people, but you got to have true motives if you do something like that. But if you struggle with stealing, why transport money from the cash register alone? If you struggle with gossip, would you let yourself hear all the information that you're being told? If you struggle with lust, would you allow yourself to go on a business trip alone with the opposite sex? Matthew 26:41, watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the body is weak. Think about those things. It's okay to think about, boy, I don't want to put myself in that situation because I want to do what's right. I don't want to look back and have regrets. I want to look back and say, man, look at what God is doing in my life. So think about what is right. Think about what potentially could be wrong. Be honest about your temptations. Say honest. Look it. Here's a key for next year. I'm telling you right now, this is going to be key. Repeat after me. See, I need to be absolutely honest about my temptations. When you can avoid temptation, you set yourself up to have less regret. And I don't know about you, but that makes me smile. It eliminates less guilt, eliminates shame, failure in my life. It reduces hurting others, my relationships, thinking about what is right, considers the cost before you commit the crime. Consider the cost, even the way we talk to people, the things that we do. Think in advance. Man, I'm kind of grumpy today. I'm going to take a couple minutes before I walk into the house and just say, God, renew my spirit. I just need you to help me right now. God, help me. Why am I angry right now? All the time I talk about, God, why am I feeling like this? And God will oftentimes say things. He'll point it out. And then he'll just say, hey, he'll work it out. Just take a few minutes. D, whatever is pure. Think about whatever is pure. Who wants to think about, you know, pure in today's world? Who can think about pure in today's world with all the corruption? Philippians 4:8 says, whatever is pure. You guys, listen to me. This year, decide to keep your hearts and minds pure. Not lusting after the attention a person can and will give you if you flirt or give yourself to them or fantasize about attention from them. This year, decide to keep your hearts, bodies, and minds pure from sexual immorality. Decide to dedicate yourself to God and His sexual standards. Put 2015 underneath the blood of Jesus and turn from it and rise up to make 2016 the greatest year of victory you've ever had. Whatever purity issue you might need. That's why you saw Ron on the video for Celebrate Recovery. Is Celebrate Recovery for drug addicts? Yes and no, not just drug addicts. How many people in this room have a habit? How many people in this room have hurts? How many people in this room have hang-ups? Good, then I expect for you to fill out your blue card and write Celebrate Recovery, because Celebrate Recovery is for everybody. I will religiously, I know I just pounced on that word, but I'm going to relentlessly push Celebrate Recovery. Because I can tell you as a pastor, I'm not the best pastor, but I know what pastoring is. And I have seen people that have gone through Celebrate Recovery, they've never touched a drug in their life, and those that have never touched their life and gone through Celebrate Recovery, and every single time, those who go to Celebrate Recovery find a way to work through the past issues in their life. Parenting, work, society, sin, hurts, pains, you become whole. It's a godly program. Everybody, not only should, must go through it. I'm telling you right now. Prove me wrong otherwise. That's how much I believe in it. We live in a world where you can sign up at a website and get with other married people who want to cheat on their spouses. We live in a world where impurity is a click away on almost any device. We live in a sex-crazed culture feeding on the visual stimulant of men with magazines on the racks. women news anchors wearing scantily clad outfits to tell people the news. Put some clothes on, lady. Ads for women, how to get men, how to get more attention for men. Give yourself away more. Movies and women so hungry for attention, they go from guy to guy just to feel loved, but on the inside, they're not smiling. And you have a whole trail of people you've had sex with giving yourself away. How many people will you have to sleep with until you find out what you're looking for is really what's going to make you smile or not, the truth? How many porn sites will you have to go on until you finally find out what you're looking for to make you smile? How many affairs will you have to have? How many will you have to flirt with? How many, whatever your issue is, whatever the devil's going to throw at you until you finally decide what you're going to smile about in life. Because the whole time, there is someone who will be more faithful to you than anyone else. And his name is Jesus. Ultimately, only he can give you what you truly need. This is not a shame sermon. This is a freeing sermon. It's the truth. I'm bringing up uncomfortable things. But I'm trying to say, decide. Is it making you happy? Looking at the sights, going to those things, sleeping with him, doing all this. Is that making you happy? No. Be honest about it. Leave it. Make the right decisions and go after the things that are true. Stop being addicted. Here's another thing. Stop being addicted to your spouse to make you happy. And start finding joy in Jesus. And maybe you'll be more a loving spouse. Titus 1:15. To the pure, all things are pure. But to those who are corrupted and do not believe, nothing is pure. In fact, both their minds and consciences are corrupted. Decide in advance that if something is ever even hinting, listen to me. I know I'm taking a little bit more time here today, guys, but I really believe that this is a sermon for us today, that God is calling us closer to him. Decide in advance that if something is even hinting at being impure, that you will consider it impure. Because to the pure, all things are either pure or not. Decide every thought, everything you view, what you say, how you say it, when you say it, what you listen to, what your flesh is wanting, you will call it what it is. Pure or not, even in advance. Boy, I'm feeling like I really want to drink right now. Boy, I'm really feeling like I want to beat their face in right now. Pure. I'm just angry. I don't want to talk right now. I don't want to be nice. I don't want to listen. Whatever it is. Pure or getting too close to not being pure. Decide. To the pure, all things are pure because the pure are always on the lookout. I'm going to say it again. To the pure, all things are pure because they're always on the lookout and they're honest about my motive ain't good there. Matthew 26:41, watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is what? This means that you know that you have the capacity to fall. This means that you admit in advance that your flesh is weak. This is taking whatever is right and applying it to the purity and to the motives, and it's a big part of that. Don't flirt with danger. Do your best to find in advance what is right and wrong. What to decide is pure or not. You might be thinking that these things, now here's something that I was preparing this, and I was getting really deep into the original language of these, and I thought, hold on a second, some people might think these are kind of like lumped together, all these things, you know, whatever's pure and noble and right, you know, it's kind of something they're all kind of lumped together. But I was praying, I felt like God, you know, wanted me to say is that, you know, you might think these things don't differ too much. Yes and no. Because they are similar. If you look at all these words, they are kind of similar, but they're similar in living for Jesus speaking. However, they each focus on a little bit deeper. They each take this living for God in a little bit deeper area. Purity, truth, noble. It's very challenging. Proverbs 15:33. The reverent and worshipful fear of the Lord brings instruction in wisdom, and humility comes before honor. Purity helps you avoid getting caught up. Anybody want to be free this year or caught up this year? I want to be free. I want to be free in the Lord and caught up in the Lord. E, whatever is lovely. Now this means kind of loving to others. Philippians 4:8, whatever is lovely. It means, you know, absence of grumbling, complaining, or murmuring. Tearing others down. Have you ever noticed it's hard to smile when you're complaining or grumbling? Have you ever noticed that? My gosh, this is the worst day in the world. The garbage is overflowing. Their clothes need to be done. I ran out of gas. I got a flat tire. It's hard, huh? Now, I'm not saying you can't complain about a tire because that's not the funnest thing. But you get what I'm saying? A lot of people walk around grumbling and complaining. It's also, when you look at this here, this type of grumbling and complaining, you're also talking about tearing people down or gossip. When you decide to lift others up, you decide to love others. So that's what it's talking about. Don't gossip. That's not loving. You're not thinking about what's lovely. How about this? Do you think it makes God smile when you're ripping into other believers or being mean or rude or tearing others down? You ready? I'm going to push the fork in right here in your marriage. You think it honors God when you talk mean or rude or just resist your spouse so you can get what you want? Not be a blessing to them. I'll only be a blessing if they're a blessing to me. Put up walls, all these different things. How can God bless that? How in the world? Live in a way that makes others smile. That will in turn help you smile. It's hard to be mean to a very truly loving person, isn't it? And you got to be evil to be mean to a person that you know is genuinely loving. Be pleasant to be around. Be kind and caring. As a leader, you can be to the point. Some of you guys are like, how do I do this as a leader in the at work or whatever? Be to the point and be direct, but showing love and kindness at the same standpoint. You don't have to be mean. You don't have to be apologetic. It's simply having the absence. You know what this is? It's not being apologetic for saying, I'm sorry, look, we've got to let you go. And it's nice to say that, but it's not like, boy, I feel bad, I had a fire. Well, sometimes there's financial issues, economic issues, they didn't do their job. What it means is just the absence, lovely, whatever is lovely, means the absence of rudeness and arrogance and harshness. Did you get that? That's a whole other sermon. Real quickly, whatever is admirable. Think about those who you really respect. Whatever is admirable. The word there in Greek is euphemus. King James says, whatever things are good report. In the Amplified, it says, whatever is kind and winsome and gracious. So in essence, it can be translated as admirable, of good repute, of good report. It means worthy. Listen to me. It means worthy, praise, reputable, high-toned, things of the highest quality. This is saying, as believers, we're to think only upon worthy things. Don't listen to gossip. Don't listen to bad reports, no matter how juicy they may seem. Also, we are not to fill our minds with junk, whether they are rumor, radio, television, off-color jokes. Our thoughts are to focus only upon worthy things, only upon that which is admirable. This is not saying don't listen. This is saying don't listen to gossip. Have a good reputation. It is just as bad to listen to gossip as it is to speak it, because then you're going to gossip. You're going to be tempted to. Also, this is not to listen to things that are not right, bad jokes and all that stuff. It's also to think and to seek for things that are constructive, not destructive, negative towards what your purpose is, towards God and what God wants. Decide to go towards things that will make you better, productive, and fulfilled in life, that what God has for you. Decide not to be someone who lets others share information for you that is not meant for you. Galatians 5:6 says this, brothers and sisters, if someone is caught in a sin, you who live by the Spirit should restore that person gently. But watch yourselves, or you also may be tempted. Carry each other's burdens, and in this way you will fulfill the law of Christ. Go straight to that person. Circle, carry each other's burdens. When you gossip, you're not carrying their burden, you're adding to it. Because knowing they have a burden, and you still make them carry it longer without your helping them, you're adding to it. And also, when you let others know their business, now you're spreading it. Do you ever think that God let you in on their problems or their issues because you're the one that God wants to maybe help them carry it? I don't know about you, but I tend to smile when I know that I'm doing something that is helping someone spiritually. Decide to think about what is admirable versus hurtful and neglectful. Choose to be someone that others admire spiritually. Man, you know what, that person? They always stop to pray for people. Man, you know what? They listen. They say, let me pray for that. Boy, I'm sorry you're going through that. Choose to be someone that others will admire. The world admires all kinds of people, but it's not spiritually beneficial. When you think about that and decide to do the previous five things, you generally will be someone that others can admire. When you think about what is noble, what is honorable, you're generally going to be someone that people can admire. And when that happens, you smile because your life is fulfilling, and it's fulfilling the purpose of God, and it changes you. Philippians 4:8 goes on to say, if anything is excellent, then he's, and basically Paul establishes those six key things that I just gave you, and then he says, it's kind of like, in other words, then he ends verse 8 with this. In other words, if anything is excellent, if anything is praiseworthy, think about those such things. How many guys would think that if we thought about, if we took times in our mind to think about things that were excellent and reject things that weren't excellent, to think about things that were praiseworthy to God and reject those that weren't praiseworthy to God, that we would have more smiling, more joy on the inside. Now, why? Why is this important? In order to have the stability you need when life tries to steal your smile. Perfect example is living for a career where the achievements you thinking are going to make you smile, but they don't last. And then you realize you missed out on your spouse or your kids. Here's what I want you to write out. Number 5. I'm going to give you a few good reasons why the Lord causes us to have smiles that last. If these things don't make you smile that I'm going to give you right now, then I don't know what will. Remember, I talked about in the Lord, rejoice in the Lord. I'm giving you that in the Lord, and I'm going to tell you right now how, by putting these things in the Lord, can truly last. Remember, you got to decide what's going to make you smile. What is your source? And I'm telling you that nothing will last longer than the Lord when you compare it. And now looking at this, why the Lord causes us to have smiles that last. A, there is rest in Him. Matthew 11:29. Let me teach you because I'm humble and gentle at heart, and you'll find rest for your souls. When you think about the six things I gave you, whatever is trustworthy, whatever is praiseworthy, all that stuff, you're resting in Him. Because you're thinking about those, you're thinking about Him, you're walking in Him. B, there is strength in Him. He gives you smiles at last because He strengthens you. Nehemiah 8:10, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. I find and take delight in the Lord. He's my joy, the things of Him. C, there is love from Him. I want you to read this next scripture to me. It's very, very familiar. But I want you to read it and grasp it. Because this is where your source is. This is where you decide. Romans 8, read it with me. No, despite all these things, overwhelming victory is ours through Christ who loves us. And I'm convinced that nothing can ever separate us from God's love. Neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither our fears for today nor our worries about tomorrow. Not even the powers of hell can separate us from God's love. No power in the sky above or in the earth below, indeed. Nothing in all creation will ever be able to separate us from the love of God that is revealed in Christ Jesus, our Lord. You guys look at me as you enter into this year. What better to think of and rely upon than the rest that is in God, than the strength that is in God, than the love from God. And as you think on what is true and noble and lovely and pure and right, He will never fail you. He will never, ever fail you. I don't know about you, but I want to smile more in 2016. I want to take my walk with the Lord more serious. Not so that I earn His love, but just so I really grasp what He's offered me. I want to grasp it all. How can this happen? Because He's glorious. And if we serve a God that is glorious, what's that make us? It makes us the result of a glorious God that doesn't make anything by mistake. Watch this video, and then we're going to pray. Watch this. Come to this place right now. You've done all that you can to make us yours, but maybe there's somebody here today, and they say, Pastor Chuck, I've never given myself to Jesus as Lord and Savior, and I need to give my life to Him. I need Him to save me. I need a Savior. and you're here today and you just want to say a prayer, I'm not going to embarrass you, I'm not going to make you come forward, but just so I know that you want me to say a prayer for you right where you're at, to say, I need Jesus to save me. Just slip up your hand right now, and I'm going to pray for you right where we're at right now. Anyone here today? Amen. Amen. Any others here today? Say, I need Jesus. Let's pray this prayer out loud. Jesus, I'm a sinner. I need a Savior. And you're the only one. And even though I don't understand it all, I know that you'll grow me and show me as I live for you. Lord, as the rest of us bring this year to a culmination in our hearts and spiritually, let us not forget that you're not trying to beat us up, you're trying to build us up. You're trying to transform us, you're trying to get the things of this world that are garbage just to fall away, to stop focusing and thinking on these things that drag us down and rob us of the joy that you have for us. Help us to truly take these things and apply them to our life, to study them over the next few weeks, because you are a God that is glorious beyond description, and yet we are yours. What a joy that is. Help us to truly be able to find our joy in the Lord, to walk in it. And God, I pray that this church would be a place in 2016 like ministry like never before, that there would be people entrusting one another to their problems, to their junk, to their garbage, to their shame, to their guilt. We would just be shamelessly, God, open and honest with each other. Because when that takes place, the gifts will really truly be able to operate the way it needs to. Your Holy Spirit will move freely. Power will take place. The enemy's grip will be lost through confession of sins and difficulties to one another, and people coming alongside of them. And now instead of one begging to get out of a temptation or issue, there's multiple people praying. And God, I pray for an anointing upon Ron and celebrate recovery and all that we got going on. And God, I pray as we start next week, kicking off this year with going beneath the surface of emotions, that that would launch us, Father, into the true discipleship and year that you're doing within us. And that, God, we dedicate this to you now, that we are here to save the lost, build the found, and take this world over for you with a relentless pursuit. They're offering new beginnings. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Bless all those here today that are hurting, going through issues. Let life groups bless one another. And we thank you now, Lord Jesus, in your name. Amen.